Good evening and welcome back, everyone. We now have our next session on chambers, cabins, and courts. Would you choose to litigate or arbitrate? That's what we're going to be discussing in this session. And this session is going to be moderated by Mr. Sameer Hossain, and he's the head legal infrastructure and structured finance at Aditya Birla Finance. I'm going to invite Mr. Sameer Hossain on the stage. Please put your hands together, everybody, and welcome Mr. Sameer. He's currently the head legal at Aditya Birla Finance, and his core expertise includes project and structured finance and stressed asset management. Being a part of the senior management, apart from normal legal functions, he is involved in strategic business planning, risk management, and advising credit committee on complex issues. And he has been instrumental in achieving zero net NPA for his business by ensuring strategic resolution of stressed accounts. His previous experience includes head legal of the project finance business in Sri Infrastructure Finance Limited and legal manager at RSIL. So we welcome Mr. Sameer, and I'm now going to invite on stage Mr. Chakradhar V. He's the Executive Vice President Corporate Legal at Godrej Industries, and he's also the authorized signatory for Godrej Consumer Products Limited and Godrej Nature's Basket Limited for all the in-house legal advisory and litigation management. Mr. Chakradhar plays a very key role in adding value to the businesses as a trusted advisor and leads a client-focused in-house legal team to handle corporate, commercial, legal, and indirect taxes related issues. Please welcome him. Next, we have with us Mr. KPS Kohli, Associate Partner at Dheer & Dheer Associates. And Mr. Kohli joined the legal profession in 2007 and has a very rich experience in domestic and international dispute resolution. And he has represented various ministries, PSUs, corporate houses, and Fortune 500 companies in industries such as telecommunications, oil and amp, natural gas, aviation, and banking. So we are also going to welcome Mr. Kohli with a round of applause. Next, I'm going to invite on stage Mr. Pankaj Patel, the head legal corporate planning at Future Group, and he's a chartered secretary from the Institute of Chartered Secretaries and Administration, London, and a qualified company secretary from the Institute of Company Secretaries of India. And he has previously worked with the Panoramic Group of Companies as a company secretary before joining Future Group as the head legal. Please welcome him. And also a part of this panel is Mr. Sachin Kalra, head legal at Bharti AXA Life Insurance, and he holds specialization in corporate law and intellectual property rights law. He pursued a career in the litigation and corporate world, in pursuit of which he joined the legal team at Vodafone, and thereafter Samsung and Bharti Retail. Sachin has a rich experience of 15 years, not only in the legal fold, but also in the compliance fold, and has a wide experience of handling a diverse range of legal matters in different industries like telecom, FMCG, retail, electronics, consumer durables, and insurance. And next I'm going to invite on stage Ms. Shweta Bharti. She is a senior partner at Hammurabi and Solomon, and heads the dispute resolution and litigation practice at the firm. She possesses a vast experience of more than a decade in dealing with dispute resolution needs and reliefs of the clients. She has represented clients in all facets of the corporate litigation and strategy. She provides an ideal combination of consistent high-quality expertise derived from immense transactional experience and innovative thought in providing solutions to delicate transactional legal needs within the often complex Indian regulations, foreign exchange rules, tax laws, and various other commercial regulations, working closely with bankers, accountants, and professionals from other disciplines. We welcome you, Shweta. Thank you for joining us. And last but not the least, we have with us Mr. S. Ravi Shankar. He's a senior partner at Law Senate, and he's a managing partner of the firm, one of the leading arbitration lawyers of India, having a strong international and domestic exposure. He's an expert arbitration lawyer handling international and domestic arbitrations. He's also a qualified advocate on record in the Supreme Court of India, with more than 21 years of experience in the field of law. So we are also very proud and privileged to have you with us, Mr. S. Ravi Shankar. Thank you for joining us. And I'm going to now hand it over to our session moderator, Mr. Sameer, who is going to take it forward from here. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. So, you know, this is Friday evening, and today is Michael Holding's birthday. You know, Michael Holding, that genuine fast bowler. And just being between people and the bar in the Friday evening is like facing Michael Holding. So I'm lucky that I have some good batsmen with me who might be able to face that. So we'll started saying, while I travel in Bombay, at times I feel our roads are as bad as Mogadishu, you know, Somalia's capital. But when I was going through this report, or World Bank report, as you would have seen on ease of doing business ranking, we have been focusing on our improvement of a rank overall, coming down to 100 from 130. So I was just going through from 2013 to 2017, last year report came, our rank has improved from, in contract enforcement, from 188 to 164. And we are behind countries like Somalia, Pakistan, Syria, South Sudan. You know. So while we are talking about arbitration or litigation, overall our situation is really, really bad in terms of enforcement of contracts. And due to this, obviously, the matter had gone to Law Commission. In fact, in 2015, we're just ahead of Bangladesh. So because of that, this entire matter had gone to Law Commission of India, and they had spent a lot of time, due to which we saw this amendment of 2015, whereby significant modification was done to the Arbitration Act. And let's hear from our panel whether that has actually changed the life. Rank has improved from 188, it has come to 164. So maybe Shweta, if you can share your experience, how it has changed.
Thank you, Samish. So I feel like, you know, Sachin Tendulkar starting the batting. So there are two ways in which I would want to see this amendment that has really impacted us. One, as practitioners, we have seen that there is now a sudden urgency that the arbitrators also are showing in terms of disposing of the cases. So they really are in a lot of hurry, which is good for the business, because that is what we really have been waiting for. There was time when we would go on for decades for the arbitration to get over, and then for the objections under 34 and 37 to get over. So at least that aspect of it has been taken care of in the amendment, that there is an expeditious hearing that is now happening, and there is a consciousness that the arbitrators have with respect to completion of the arbitration proceedings. But then there is another flip side to it, and that is where the intervention of the court has really created a lot of complication around, is the Section 34 interpretation. Now, I would want to really talk about a case that I'm handling, and that is when I started to dwell a little more onto this issue, is that there is a matter where the award has been passed after the amendment. So once the award has been passed after the amendment, so the amended act should apply to this kind of a case, is what my logical understanding was, before I could realize that there are divergent views of different courts which is there on this issue. So Calcutta High Court has a different view, which was similar to what my view was, that once you have an award which is subsequent to the amendment, so the amended act would apply to the Section 34 that you file. But Mumbai High Court has a completely different view. I would want to come to the Delhi High Court view, because that is what impacted me the most. Because Delhi High Court, what it did in the RD Infrastructure versus Anuradha Bhatia cases, they divided it into three brackets. So what they did is that if it is a pre-award and if the arbitration proceedings have initiated before the amendment and the award has also come before the amendment, for those kind of circumstances, Section 34, if you file Section 34, then the amended provisions would apply. But if the arbitration proceedings have commenced before and award has come after the amendment, in such circumstances, the old act would apply. So my logical conclusion or understanding was completely devastated. And ultimately, what I was relegated to was that I should now wait for Section 34 to get over before I could complete my execution. So I would not say that all the hurdles that we wanted with the amendment has been crossed, but yes, we have at least made a headway. So that is the reason why now the Law Commission is already contemplating again another amendment to this amendment, so that all these issues are also taken care of.
So just to get a view from the other side, from the cabins, Sachin, you want to add something?
Yeah. See, Act has come up 2015, very welcome to us. Industry has seen it in a positive way. Time schedule has been changed. Court's interference is less to the side. Wherever the award is there, interference is less. They don't want to interfere. Like, there are many judgments which has come up. Tata Docomo judgment was there. Cyrus judgment is there. All judgments which are there. FEMA regulations violated, RBI violated, these are applications been filed. court has not interfered and went forward to take it forward. He said that it should be as a merit only, and they have to be limited only. They cannot go into merits of the case. They have to be limited that biasness is not there. Something, public policy has not been taken care. So as a in-house counsel, I see that arbitration definitely is a good process to work on today. Seeing the earlier scenarios, I also was struggling for the case from 2011 to 2018. 7 years, one of the cases in arbitration is still pending, and I have incurred a cost of more than the amount which was to be recovered from the person. So situation was really on a bad shape earlier. Now it's changed, and I think it's going to be better tomorrow. As Shweta also said, there should be a new amendments as our government is working in day by day amendment. Like IBC, in a year, this amendment. Similar arbitration, they will be having amendment, seeing the scenario, seeing the blockage, how to come up with it. Because the agenda of government is to have how to ease the doing the business, basically. And ease of business can be done only when the corporates are satisfied with the process.
See, the other interesting, because you raised of the cost, the other interesting data which is there in the World Bank report, you see, which has not changed in the last 4 or 5 years, the cost to realization value is around 30%. So if you recover 100 crore, you have spent 30 crores in the process, which is way high compared to the global standards. So you say in SEAC where people say you end up spending 8-9%, which is so high. And in India, it's very low, the cost. But actual effective cost is very, very high. Mr. Ravi Shankar, what's your thought on that?
On the cost.
Yes.
See, we, you know, many times we also underestimate our system. Internationally, all international arbitrations are more expensive than the so-called sitting fee system of India. The only problem was number of sittings, which were very, very high earlier. After this 2015 amendment came in, now globally, ICC's average period of disposing an international arbitration is from 18 months to 24 months. But in India, if they do it in Bombay or Delhi, they have to complete their arbitration within 12 months. That is the compulsion. Now they are working on it. So India is becoming a very attractive destination with regard to international arbitrations when Indian parties are on the defense side. Because for two reasons. One is the way in which the arbitrations are getting concluded in 12 months. Number two, while challenging an award, you require a separate stay. So the party has to make a deposit. These two reasons give a lot of boost to the local India-seated arbitrations. Number second is with regard to the cost. See, cost, actually, I always feel that we always underestimate the party autonomy in arbitration. The beauty of arbitration agreement is parties can decide everything and anything they want to decide and put it in the arbitration clause. Nobody can touch it. But who does touching this? Government will come and restrict it by way of regulation. They will, and number two is courts will interpret in such a way to help somebody like DMRC case, in which they said DMRC can choose, they can give a panel, 10 people, but still you can select. This is absurd. Third thing is the arbitral institutions. For example, Mumbai International Arbitration Center. What they are doing is you appoint, there are three arbitrator panel. You appoint one, I appoint one. Chairman will be appointed only by the arbitral institutions. These are all curtailing. Actually, you can decide your fee. You can decide the way in which arbitration should happen. You can decide how many sittings it should be. You can decide whether the arbitration should be paperless or hearingless or online, whatever it is. Whatever you decide has to happen. That is where the full beauty of arbitration can be enjoyed. I think a day will come.
That's wonderful to hear. Mr. Kohli, you want to add something?
Yes, no, just to add, I think the one of the key issues which regarding the cost. I think in arbitration in India, we still are not at a stage where the arbitral tribunal will eventually give you the, if to a winning party, the entire cost of the litigation. In all the foreign jurisdictions, foreign seated arbitrations, the foreign arbitration that we do, I think the biggest fear is to not to lose what we are claiming. Because if you lose, you end up paying the cost of the other party for defending your false claim. But in India, we keep on adding claims, and that's where probably they have to work on to curtail the cost and to ensure the arbitration is done more effectively. You narrow down the issues, what is it that you are, what is actually in dispute, rather than claiming damages even if there are none. So that's a standard prayer in all arbitrations, probably, that even if there is a breach of contract and you put in and there are liquidated damages provided, you still keep on claiming some other damages. There's a standard prayer in all the arbitrations, and of course the cost goes up. If you lead evidence on it, the time is wasted. The other party puts their pleadings on it, leads some evidence to defer your claim. So I think that actually adds to the cost, and probably that's why we actually have to look at the arbitrators, where they actually put a cost to the other party if they lose their claim.
And so one more thing, what's your thought on single versus three arbitrators? What has been your experience?
Single versus three arbitrators, and I've shared it many times. I think I'll tell you the good ones and the bad ones. The bad one was two ex Supreme Court Chief Justice and one Supreme Court judge. The entire arbitration proceeding, the Chief Justice never came with their files. It is the Supreme Court judge who used to bring it, and international arbitration, everybody used to share his files. Every time any party files an interim application, you have to carry files to extra copies for the arbitrator, even if you have served the copies weeks earlier. So this is with the three arbitrators, and whether it is necessary or not, it's of course, and I agree with sir, it all depends upon party's own decision. If you have three people, if you think the matter is such which requires three arbitrators, you should have three arbitrators. But most of the matters, if you look at the issues which are very narrow, you need one arbitrator who's an expert in that field. This is one mistake that most of the arbitration that are done, that we don't go to people who are experts in that field which requires an expert to adjudicate upon. We by default go to a retired high court judge, be a district court, high court or supreme court. We don't go for people who are expert in that field, who can bring much more from their own experience to the arbitration. Because if you look at the Indian arbitrations, there are very few places where the arbitrators actually interfere or ask questions. Probably in a cross-examination, they may, in their own court style, would say, no, this question is not valid, that question is not valid. But as a expert arbitrator, they don't bring anything to the table except what parties put together before them. But in an international scenario, an expert arbitrator can actually help you a lot. He cannot be, taken astray. You can't mislead him. The other party can't mislead him. He'll know, and he himself would understand the issue. So I think that's where we should move forward to now.
Mr. Kohli is going to, in the words of closing the business of retired judges now.
No, not at all. And I'm not saying in the public.
So?
No, I'm saying it is only for the party's benefit. Yeah, and even if when the claim is less, and I was just sharing it with them that last week in Nagpur, the principal of Nagpur High Court has actually appointed a retired High Court judge of the Nagpur bench, when the principal is only 20 lakhs. So what would be the cost? The cost, of course, would be high. Anybody who's quite young, who understands the commercial dispute, it's a commercial dispute. So a single young arbitrator who has experience in this field would be an excellent arbitrator rather than a retired judge, considering the value of the matter also.
So based on your experience, getting the three arbitrators on a hearing, how difficult is it? Or you see a lot of adjournments if you have three? In ad hoc, in particularly.
In ad hoc, sharing the same experience with the judges, we had a Section 17 hearing. We did the hearing, and then one of the judges said, "I have an eye operation, and I am not available for next 2 months." So, a Section 17 application was not decided for 2 months. So these kind of experiences you face with an ad hoc arbitration, but with an institutional arbitration, and that's probably where there's always a check on the timelines. An institution will have not of course the check on the meat of the matter, but check on the procedural aspects of it. Like, what is the timeline for an arbitrator? They give a timeline, a range to the arbitrator. Within this, you have to decide the issues. They also help the arbitrator at times if they need any checks on the secretarial side of it. And also they do check the awards for the quality of it. At times it happens in ad hoc arbitrations, you'll find that certain submissions are being recorded which were never made. But all these they don't usually happen in an institutional arbitration, because they already have a framework, they have their rules. So you understand that your arbitration would flow in particular set of rules which you have pre-agreed upon. Because once you come into a dispute, nobody will agree with the other party. So that's what my experience, that if once the arbitration starts, so nobody agrees with the other party on anything. So it is better that while drafting the arbitration agreement, you should think it through everything. A, you decide the rules, you decide the law which is applicable, you decide who will be the, either a single arbitrator or three arbitrators. You also decide the procedure, and the procedure has to be well defined. It cannot be vague. Or you decide upon a institution that you'll go to in case you do, a situation arises where you have to do an arbitration. So probably if all these things are well defined, you can actually finish your arbitration in a very time-bound manner. Because usually what happens is Section 11 appointment of an arbitration takes years in this court. And I was also sharing my experience that probably after the amendment, the arbitration roster judge probably is very good and fast and he understands things. But if you file a Section 8 before any other proceeding, let's assume a writ petition, if it is a government and there's an arbitration contract, and the party has come in a writ against you and you move a Section 8 application, or you tell the judge that you can't do this in arbitration. They take on public policy issues that no, but there'll be a cost of arbitration to you also and to them also. Why would government bear the arbitration cost? Why don't you take these kind of decisions? And we have faced this. So I think after the amendment, out of the roster judges, it is the other judges before whom the proceedings are initiated and you move a Section 8 that there's an arbitration clause. They should also, take up this cause and refer the parties to arbitration rather than, deciding the matters and not deciding a Section 8 application for years.
Thank you. Just coming back to cabins now, Mr. Chakradhar, how do you decide arbitration or court?
Okay, thank you for that, Samir. As a in-house counsel, I see myself as a business partner, and the experiences that I have got in terms of being an in-house counsel and a business partner has been to look at all these means that we just now spoke about, whether they will achieve the end. Because that's what I'm concerned for, because that's what's going to ultimately make my job shine. So the various means that we so far talked about have only talked about the arbitration, the methods, the philosophy behind it, the purpose for which it has come into existence. But none of us have actually heard so far, there are other words called mediation and conciliation in the very same act. I give a lot of importance to it. And even assuming that I fail at a mediation or a conciliation, during the process of the arbitration, I, as a counsel for a business, never ever shied out in terms of talking it out as to what needs to be done to ensure closure of a proceeding. The reason why I'm talking about it from this perspective is, in the cabins that we hold fort for, what is seen is essentially the same kind of a discussion on what is the cost-benefit analysis. So if it is not yielding a benefit, don't incur the cost. Because they always look at it as the investment being made to ensure an end. They don't want to look at it as an expenditure over and above a particular level. So in this process, the essential emphasis for me as a business partner in a cabin is to see how much of rapprochement is possible while the proceeding is on. So I don't look at only relying on counsel, retired high court judges, number of adjournments, number of arbitrators, whether the senior most supreme counsel is hired or not. That's not of importance. But the most important thing for me is how best and how fast I can achieve an end, whichever means that I adopt. So in this process, I closely look and watch for what is the ultimate situation that I can encounter and get to the result and the end. Therefore, I never look at the other side party as an adversary to me. That's the fundamental principle that I played so far in my role as a cabin manager or a business partner. That's where the meat is, and that's what the business expects from you if you are a counsel in-house. And I recall my own experience of having seen the new Act of Arbitration and Conciliation 1996 coming in. an international arbitration having started against the international business of ITC where I was. And then we were looking at the what is the right method of letting know the party that the usage of that international arbitration forum to what extent is right and when it should have actually started or should it have actually retraced its steps and talked to us. Because merely because there is a availability of a forum outside of India, you can't emphasize to say I will go in for an international arbitration is the position that we have taken in that particular case. And we did get local court support at that point in time. Of course, there is a labyrinth of precedentiary value that has come in and the entire dimension has changed today. The climate is more towards leaning for arbitration to progress rather than stop it. I do appreciate that. But the specifics of your case, if you really want to say that this is not part of the justice system that you should approach as something agreeable and therefore you should stop it, then if there is a means in the act, do use it, whether it is section 34 or not. That's the way I look at it. But sum and substance of the changes that have happened in the act from the UN Citral model of 1996 to the amendments that we have made possible, I think the journey over a period of 20 plus years has given us betterment of the situation, a leaning pro towards getting things resolved, a thought process where institutional arbitration is being encouraged by almost all the courts, and that's a plus for the businesses today. But whether we will go in all situations for only arbitration is a fundamental question in cabins. Therefore, it depends on exact situation that we encounter. We rather look at it from the purposes of looking at what mediation, what conciliation will be done prior to going in for the full-fledged proceeding in the arbitration.
So we'll just move a little more specific. Many of you would have read Zia Modi's book on 10 judgments that transformed India. Unfortunately, that book was written a few years back. Had that book been written now, definitely one judgment has a good chance of getting into it. And that is the Docomo judgment. So Pankaj, if you can share your thoughts and the implications of the judgment, both at the arbitration as well as the court level.
Before I will discuss about the Tata Docomo judgment, I will share you about my experience, which is identical like Tata Docomo judgment. In that case, basically, there was a joint venture where both the parties have agreed that, you know, in case if the business is not doing well, they will contribute certain percentage of amount towards an equity so that the business can come out of the difficulty. Both the parties have to bring only 20-20 CR. Against that, one of the party has backed out and then he has dragged the people into Singapore International Arbitration, SIAC. There, surprisingly, he spent actually 20 crore as a cost. And he made me also to spend around 10 crore. Had he spent, and nobody has won that case, finally that matter has been disposed of because SIAC has realized that, you know, tribunal has realized that and it is not worth to fight it out, you know, where, because you know, he's unnecessarily dragging the matter. What was finally being decided, had he invested that money, I endorsed with Mr. Chakravarti's view, what he was telling, basically, in case if he would have invested into the business, that business would have revived. Then he would have got a better valuation than he was expecting from the tribunal. Even it was an observation of a tribunal, okay, what money you can't get it from your business, you are expecting from an arbitration award, which is not acceptable. Now coming back to the Tata Docomo judgment is basically, it is a interesting part is basically where how the contract in case of an, how the international award can be enforced effectively. And what are the impediments for enforcement of a contract in India in case even if somebody has a foreign award. There is a fixed price put option which is available to Docomo. That, you know, in case if, even if irrespective of whatever is the net worth of the company, he can always take it back 50% of the money because just for this is just for protection of the downward side. It is not something which he is getting it. After he got an award from an LCIA, when they came for an enforcement, they said since the net worth of the company is around 22,000 crore and the net worth are eroded so much, but still I am entitled to take it 11,000 crore back. Initially, Tatla was reluctant. Why? Because they said, you know, in case if the, because it's a Reserve Bank circular, they were asking for a Reserve Bank, basically, in case even if the fair value of the shares has gone down, can we repatriate the money back? Then Reserve Bank has intervened in the Delhi High Court where they wanted to enforce the contract, they wanted to challenge it. They were saying that, you know, you can't send the money back more than the fair valuation. Then Justice Muralidhar, he has given a very nice judgment in that case, which is an actually a historical judgment, which I think should be there in a Zia Bodhi's book. He was telling that, you know, intervention of an arbitration, intervention of a Reserve Bank of India is uncalled for here. Why? Because it is not the money which they are taking it based on a fair valuation, it is the damages which they have granted and they have been agreed also. RBI cannot enter into a contract in that manner when they have brought in 22,000 crore and now they wanted to take it back as per the LCI order. If thereafter, if RBI will enter in and if that award will not be enforced in an international arena, enforceability where we are standing today will again go downward. So that's why for an international perspective, just to see that, you know, it has been recorded in that judgment, to see that, you know, India is good in case of an enforceability of a contract. At the same time, India is in a position, then they are honoring the award. He has said RBI interventions cannot be allowed, and then he has allowed for an enforcement of a contract. See, these two situations, why it is so important? Why? Because after initial reluctance of a Tata, RBI has rejected twice. Thereafter also, when internationally, if somebody is saying, like today's Daiichi and Ranbaxy judgment, when CAK has passed 3,500 crore of damages, even Supreme Court has refused it. Now court is taking that proactively facilitator role instead of intervention. Otherwise, what will happen? People will not invest in India. They will not believe in an Indian entrepreneur. Otherwise, they will see that, you know, even if you invest the money, it is gone forever. This perception has to be broken. Then we will have a more amount of inflow which will come in India. More amount of joint venture will happen. More amount of business will happen. From that perspective, arbitrator has to become facilitator. Reason being, arbitrator is not governed by the CPC. But arbitrator has so many powers which is there in a CPC of the court which is being granted under the CPC. So in case if he is having the power but not a responsibility, then why can't he become a facilitator like a co-panelist, the way he was telling that, you know, if we can appoint an expert as an arbitrator, it is not necessary to keep somebody as a retired judge. So that he understand the business, he understand the dispute, and he will try to resolve it. Instead of giving he has won and he has lost, he has got the award and it was against him, he will try to resolve it and gives a kind of a solutions which can be enforced easily.
So just taking it forward, because it's a very interesting point and can be argued either way. So if you see Docomo's case where it was not allowed to take return beyond a point, and you say I'm claiming damages and take it by coloring it differently, or even there is another judgment of Uptown where the Bombay High Court, as per RBI guideline, fixed returns are not allowed on an equity instrument because then it becomes debt practically. So Bombay High Court said it is nothing but coloring. Then Supreme Court later said no, these are, so one company was put in between to show as two separate companies.
In Docomo, both parties, Tata agreed to.
Agreed. Both were agreed.
Respect the award. It is RBI saying no, you can't repeat.
So point is, if there is a law, there is a regulation, because RBI is acting as a regulator to manage the currency and the policies of. So it might go under a different policy if you want to do it. For example, in the other one, it could have gone under FDI. They did under ECB. And for example, so can you? My point is this. I'm not going either way. I'm just asking for your view. Can you indirectly color something to bypass a regulation and just in the name of easy
business?
This is
not bypassing.
No, actually, in Tata Docomo, the judge actually noted that in the LCI award, they have considered these issues. These issues were framed in the arbitration tribunal, that whether if the money is repatriated out of India, will that be a violation of any RBI regulations or foreign exchange regulations? So that these issues were raised, these issues were decided by the arbitral tribunal. And the High Court relied upon those very findings to say that they have actually looked into these issues. And I also don't find that whatever they have held is against the law. And that's why they said, RBI, you can't interfere. And these issues that you are raising are in fact being considered. Furthermore, RBI, they in fact noted the internal notings of RBI, where RBI has actually agreed to Tata's request. But it is the ministry probably who didn't agree, and that's why they rejected it.
So fair point. So I have just a specific question to Mr. Ravi. Sure. So taking this example again, where basically the reason why it was possible is because of a clause, largely because of a clause, saying you will sell it to somebody outside India where it is allowed. So if that is the ratio we follow, then in all cases you can bypass it using this. What's your thought on that?
See, the thinking is like this. Globally, first time we have seen Docomo, but China has decided it about 20 years back. Globally, the basis of international arbitration is you should not keep foreign exchange regulations as a matter of public policy.
Correct.
Otherwise, none of the awards can be executed. Every single foreign award can be challenged in the destination where it is going to be executed, saying that this is violative of our foreign policy of India. So globally, there is a consensus that a foreign exchange regulation is not a matter of public policy. So in my opinion, I fully support the Docomo judgment because that ensures the global consistency in interpretation.
So basically, you are saying if it is an arbitration, then even if there is a FEMA regulation, which is contradicting with the award.
Yeah, that's okay. What. The foreign exchange regulation is only a matter of regulation for maintaining your foreign exchange level of a country. It is not like a statute. So there is a difference. But you have seen, you must have seen this Daiichi case.
Right.
In which they have brought in one dilution, saying that a minor, you cannot enforce this award against a minor. Because that is a part of public policy. Because we protect the minors contractually. So this award goes beyond that legislative limit. So we cannot enforce this award against those minors. So it is only a procedural, like the regulatory is just a procedural thing. If that is allowed, the convention, New York Convention, what all of us have signed will become meaningless. No award can be enforced in another.
Similar order was given in Cruise City versus Unitech case also, where the FEMA regulation was violated. The court was of the similar view that when award has been passed, you cannot go beyond that and it should be adhered and enforced, actually.
Right.
See, Satluj Construction Limited recently, Supreme Court has decided the court has to actually, in order to decide any matter to set aside based on a public policy, it has to shake the conscience of the court. Court cannot thereafter just replicate its view about the arbitrator view, otherwise the arbitration becomes meaningless. Otherwise, court will decide that they will go into the fact and they will say that, you know, arbitrator has not decided. They cannot go into the merit on that. It has to shook the conscience of the court in a manner, then only they can go. Like in this Daiichi case, they have gone for a minor. You know, in a minor case, their estate will earn only 4-5 lakh rupees to enforce against them for 3,500 crore is not worth. That's why they have excluded the minor from that.
Right. See, you want
to? He has a question.
Sure.
No, see, I personally feel that judgment, to some extent, because Tatas have agreed to pay that amount, therefore it became enforceable. But otherwise, if you look at the law says when a foreigner is investing in India, he has to be governed by Reserve Bank of India regulation. And regulations clearly stipulate that in case you dilute your shares, then you have to take the market price. And whatever the value, you will be getting that money. So therefore, according to me, even in case of Tata and Docomo, I think there is a misjudgment. For the simple reason is that today their party is above board, but there will be Indian parties who cannot legally send the money abroad. They will get an award from outside, which will be against them, and thereby they will transfer funds from India outside. And New York Convention very clearly stipulates that in case an arbitrator violates the law of the contract, then that award can be set aside on that ground. Means it will not be enforced in India. No doubt an international award is alive as far as the party has assets outside India. But as far as Indian public policy is concerned, there are no doubt, I know that it has been now strictly not followed just to show that we are becoming liberal as far as interpretation of foreign awards are concerned. But still we have to keep in mind the overall interest of the country also while deciding these issues.
Singhane sir, can I answer what you are saying? Prior to they arriving into the consent, when Tata has challenged it under Section 34 before the Delhi High Court, they were saying that Tata Sons, who has given the guarantee pertaining to this investment which they have made it, they have an assets in London, they have an assets in UK, they can enforce it, that award, to recover the money from them. Thereafter, Tata has bended and they have agreed for the consent term. Why I am saying, suppose if RBI intervention would have been allowed, there are two things which would have happened. That award could have been still recovered from the assets of Tata Sons, which is staying at UK, point number one. And point number two, the perceptions that India is not there to enforce any award, irrespective whether it is a foreign award and all, will be prevailing everywhere. That will also...
But to answer your question, I think in Tata, they did answer. The judge actually considered the issue. He said that since it is not a promise that the upside would be on the total investment. He said that it is only a guarantee to the investor that he can only get at least 50% of his money back of what he has invested. So he has said since this kind of a clause is not a violation of a FEMA rules, that's why they are entitled to take that money. And in fact, he said at the end that whatever would be transferred, it would be subject to all the applicable taxes and all, and then the money would be repatriated. In this case, at least, he did consider that there is no violation since it is not an upside, a guaranteed upside on the investment. It is the minimum guarantee of the total investment that is made, which is less than his investment. So he says it is not. So in this case, at least, he considered this issue. Probably in another matter, if somebody doesn't look at it in this way and say, no, the courts have been holding that even if there is a violation of law in India, you still enforce arbitration award, probably you have not reached that stage with Tata.
No, that is what I am trying to say. That the courts in India always have to keep in mind when they talk about public policy, that the arbitrator, whether the arbitrator, while considering the arguments of both the parties, have considered whether about the Indian regulations also, because that is also an important part of enforcement procedure. And that is what is the party autonomy or country autonomy provided under the New York Convention also, that each country can frame their own rules. Only question here is that in India we have not been very elaborate on the public policy ground, which has been used, I would say not being used, but misused earlier. So therefore I rest my case.
You juxtapose this position vis-a-vis not arbitration, but with reference to a court proceeding in a foreign land. For example, an Indian party has entered into a contract and there is a money claim, and thereafter the party in the foreign land has gone and approached a court and there is a decree. And that is being enforced. And thereafter, money is agreeable to be paid by this party. Indian party has to go to RBI and say that I have suffered a decree and it has to send out a money. At that point in time, RBI cannot question to say that did you agitate everything that is possible for you in that foreign land. There is a decree and that has become final, and RBI has to allow this party to send out the money. Why I juxtapose this position is that in my own experience, such situation was there 15 years ago, which I myself have made as an application to RBI, and RBI had to allow it after considering all the detail.
I think personally speaking, that is a different matter. If you are fighting in a foreign court and there is a judgment against you of a foreign court, actually if you are an Indian party, you have been allowed to set up a subsidiary abroad.
No, but you had an argument saying that the money is going out from the country and parties can set it up like this and money can be taken away even this way also. But no. RBI had no such recourse to say that no, you are sending out the money by way of saying that there is a decree against you. No. Because you were raising that one point saying that parties then can...
No, I am saying this is a possible
for you
risk.
To get send the money.
This is a possible risk, actually.
May I just add one point? Yeah. So, I think fair point. I think the point which all of us should address is that a put option with a fixed IRR, the Reserve Bank of India has been very, very clear since 2010 in Reach Cargo, where they've given an official letter to say that a fixed IRR is not enforceable. But in the Docomo case, it's very different. It's not about the FMV valuation or any kind of a downside or upside protection, though the case law talks about that. It is a breach of a clause to not provide an exit which the party was supposed to give. And between two non-residents, that exit could have been provided. And because of that breach of that clause, there was a cause of action which was damages. Now, damages, a resident can always pay to a non-resident. So RBI has not objected to that issue in the first place to begin with. And I can say this with a lot of certainty because we acted for Docomo. Okay.
If you read Section 73 of a Contract Act, which says that if both the parties agreed and in contemplation of a breach, they have already agreed that this is a damage which has to be paid by the by the party who is breaking the contract, then right. It is actually enforceable.
Absolutely.
Keeping aside the FEMA issue, in case if the both the party would have been Indian, this is something which has been written and now it is being endorsed by an by way of an arbitration award also. So it has to be enforced.
Absolutely. 73-74 liquidated damages.
Shweta, you want to add something?
Yeah, I just wanted to add here that, you know, we are talking of two different things here. One is with respect to the transfer of shares, and another is with respect to the quantum of damages. So far as the quantum of damages is concerned, obviously the arbitration award has to prevail and there is no confusion about it, and it will pass the test of the public policy also. But so far as the transfer of shares is concerned, I think there is a requirement for an amendment in the FEMA Act. If you know, we can contemplate a situation like this where where we can actually give away with the requirement for the calculation of the fair market value and let the party autonomy at that point of time also take prevalence over this issue, because otherwise there is a regulation very specifically on it. So the calculation ought to have been under the fair market value. So that is what my understanding is.
So we'll just move to some of the other points, otherwise we'll get stuck here. See, another interesting point which came up when this 2015 amendment came up was regarding impartiality. A lot of focus was there.
Yes.
The schedule was added up. So Mr. Ravi, if you want to share some thought on that.
Impartiality.
Yes, impartiality of arbitrators.
See, all of us know well, at least 2 years back, if you see 3-member arbitrator panel, if they are sitting, one of the arbitrator will be clarifying one of the counsel's arguments. The questions will be interpreted by him. So they will be acting as if like a party's representative sitting in the tribunal, which was so embarrassing. And finally, all of us used to rely on God, saying that whatever the chairman of the tribunal is going to decide is going to be the result of this thing. So in addition to that, another problem was some of the companies, particularly public sector and government undertakings, were appointing the same people for so many arbitrations. So, if sitting with you, he will be talking to that GC. When is the next arbitration you are referring to me? Your chief was telling that he will meet me tomorrow. What will happen? So, the private party will be bleeding through his nose. So, it was a beautiful attempt done by the government by bringing in the IBA's guidelines on international rules of conflict of arbitration in international arbitrations as a part of Schedule 517. 517 is giving you certain guidelines how you can test the impartiality and independence of the arbitrators. And in that, now the 5 has become somehow got diluted in my opinion because of the HRD case in which the court has said it is simply a guideline for the arbitrator's declaration to the parties. It does not disqualify anybody, or it need not be taken as disqualification. So you require some more thing to prove that it has an impact on Schedule 7. Then only that Schedule 5 points will have some value. Even though it goes like that, in my opinion, even Schedule 7 ensures some kind of impartiality and independence in Indian arbitration situation, which will be really helpful in the years to come. What I can suggest to all the GCs is, please don't look for somebody who will really support your case. Better you look for somebody who will ensure justice. If we go with that kind of a mindset and approach, I'm telling you, arbitrations will start yielding the predicted results. The best lawyer or a best GC is who? He should be able to predict what will be the outcome of the arbitration. That can happen only when you don't bet on some people. Instead, you bet on your facts and information. That will help. So please ensure impartiality and independence, which will bring in some...
One Tamil saying is there in this connection I wanted to share. Ravi was speaking. It says, instead of going and trying to find out whether the panchayat head is going to be doing you good, better you go to the adversary and talk and close your matter.
That's good.
That's the best way of approach for conciliation and achieving your end. Why I am saying this is the dilemma about conflict of interest and the arbitrator, whether he will be without bias conducting the proceedings, whether the entire proceedings will go in a manner where it is fair and justice is ensured. If these have to be seen as forefront for any proceeding, then first think through. This is what my experience has been in in-house counsel. think through as to from which approach the other party is looking at your claim and to what extent you can walk along halfway or midway to ensure that you achieve the means and the end together while walking that path of ensuring company's interest is protected. Thank you.
There's just to add to this, in fact, you know, there are 2-3 judgments which have come recently exactly on the issue of the employees being the arbitrators. So far as the present employees are concerned, they cannot be an arbitrator. That is a settled law now. Asenia case also talks about that, passed by Delhi High Court. But there is an interesting judgment which has been passed by Punjab and Haryana High Court in the Reliance Infrastructure versus Haryana Power.
So the past employees says, can be.
Yeah, the past employees can be the arbitrator even now. So that is a distinction that has been created now in Section 12.
Adding to this, there is a TRF case which was there, which MD was supposed to appoint a nominee arbitrator. So that was also taken off by the rights that when an MD don't have a right to be arbitrator, he appointing a nominee will not also be right. So it was taken off by the court.
Like in government contracts, they normally mention that, you know, the head of that institution has to become an arbitrator who is an employee of a government. If you make him an arbitrator, of course, that it is fixed that, you know, it will go to the...
In fact, Mr. Ravi's statement was reminding me of one judgment passed by Justice Sanjeev Banerjee of Calcutta High Court, where he passed reference about one of the leading NBFCs based out of Calcutta. And there was one particular arbitrator who used to pass thousands of awards in favor of that NBFC. So Justice Banerjee said that this man looks to be like award printing machinery. And there were some memo numbers of that NBFC was mentioned in that award because it was printed out of the same NBFC. So there are those issues are there. And any other view you want to add on one-sided arbitration clauses?
See, in one-sided arbitration clauses, actually it came to an end when this 2015 amendment came in. Even I was writing a proud article, no more one-sided arbitration clauses in India. But unfortunately, recently Supreme Court has opened up in a different way in DMRC case, in which DMRC has a panel of 31 arbitrators. Most of them are their own retired engineers. And DMRC says, this is the way in which the arbitrators has to be chosen. So you have to select one among them, and we will select one among them. The other chairman also will be selected. So people like Mukul Rohtagi as an attorney general appeared in the matter. So he convinced the court, see, you have to give some kind of a leverage and special treatment to the government companies. In fact, in my opinion, it should not be 100%. And the court is convinced saying that you go for a broad-based panel by including. They have included 10 more judges, 10 more another type of chartered accountants from somewhere, and they have created a 51 members panel. In my opinion, these are all very, very unwanted things. This should not happen. Particularly, government contracts are not negotiated contracts. Private parties, we negotiate. Every class, we negotiate. But government contracts are printed and thrown on you. Either you accept or go to hell. That is what is happening. So those contracts should have, in my opinion, lesser value in terms of judicial scrutiny. But unfortunately, Supreme Court has done this. I hope a day will come, they will correct their mistake and ensure that parties' will should be fully respected. If I have an opportunity to appoint, I can appoint anybody. That should be the spirit behind a fair and the equal and efficient arbitration.
See, another interesting point, Mr. Kohli, is arbitration by reference, which has undergone a lot of change based on how the courts have viewed it.
Correct.
What is your thought on that?
Arbitration by reference, they say that even it's, in fact, it's a very simple concept. It's not rocket science in it. It's very simple that if it can be, even if you, it's arbitration is not part of your contract, it can be read into an agreement if the parties from the exchange of their emails or from the correspondence, it is clear. Well, what is an arbitration agreement? Arbitration agreement has to be a written document, the essentials of it, that it has to be a written agreement, a written clause in a document, either by emails, by letters, or in a signed contract. So if your agreement doesn't have a arbitration clause, but thereafter you begin to negotiate probably on those lines. So that can be read into by inference that you have agreed that for a dispute arising out of this contract, you should go to arbitration. is what is an arbitration, an incorporation of an arbitration clause in an agreement by.
Sorry. But I think this concept of reference for an arbitration has been brought in also because of a CPC amendment, which essentially looked at probably situation turning towards the arbitration. And I think with many of the judgments and precedents throwing us to go to arbitration route, this reference method is something which is going to be adopted more and more by the courts. That's my view.
Somebody's thinking about you.
So last question, after that I'll open up to the audience, is regarding the future of arbitration. And you know, most of us like Singapore, we have seen how Singapore has created a legal tourism out of it. So so what is your thought, Pankaj, on possibility of building up legal tourism in India, considering the fact that we are still at 164 in contract enforcement?
See, that is only possible provided we change our mindset. We change our mentality in terms of our dealing with our partners, whether it is foreign or a domestic. The reason being, you know what normally people's, what was the past of arbitration is, it was considered as a pre-litigation stage. They were knowing that, you know, if award will come, I just have to file an application in 34, it will be stayed automatically. Once it is admitted, it is stayed irrespective of asking of anything. In a court also they said, like for example, if you go to US, they will say, we will see in court, see you in court. So they are scared, then if somebody will drag you in the court, they will get a good amount of money through the court only. But here, they said that we will see in the court, area, ja dekh le. Because they know that, you know, in the court number of years, nothing will happen. In order to change, as a, for a legal tourism, we have a lot of intellectuals. We have a person like Harish Salve, who practices in SIEC. He, most of the time, he is in London and all. Such an intellectual people, those who are there, such an intellectual and a cream legal fraternity is here. But still, because of our mindset, the moment we are in India, we behave in a completely different manner. So first step towards this amendment of 23rd October 2015. Second, I think that institution which has came up, MCIA, which is there. Now, what we have to do as a role of a cabin manager or as a role of a general counsel, we start trying to, it becomes a little difficult for us to persuade our foreign partners that, you know, okay, now you can also get your award enforced faster in India. You have a better legal support here. You have a better ad hoc arbitration institution here. But till today, I am not successful after that amendment has came, and after MCI was also set up on 8th October 2016. Not even in single contract, my UK partner or US partner in any joint venture, they have agreed. They only wanted to take it to Singapore. The best things which is happening presently in this Docomo judgment, as well as in case of this Daiichi judgment, which was Supreme Court has rejected this to stay that High Court order of Renbexi, is when people will start looking at you. See, to change that mindset, it requires time. One is to change our mindset, and other is to change our perception in the eyes of others. How it will change, when we will show that, you know, we are being faster. Like, there was a lot of debate and discussion which was going on in various forum, mentioning that, you know, in 18 months, how it is going to possible to resolve and not. I always believe that, you know, if you see most of the arbitration outside India, in an LCIA or CA, it has taken place in, they were able to conclude it within 18 months. Means, you know, the arbitration which I have taken place, I have conducted. So what I have seen that, you know, suppose if we change that mindset, instead of looking at the time, if we see that, you know, if we in a speed, if we will able to conclude, and not only looking upon for the retired judges, but we will appoint an expert who understand the business, then this legal tourism can happen. Then this will work like mediations and arbitration. Arbitrator will become a facilitator for resolving a dispute. In a CAC building in Singapore, you will find that, you know, there is a conciliation office just downstairs. There the mediation and all, mediation sale is happening, mediation is happening there. Of course, it is not connected with that. It's a Merrill Corp, that building Maxwell at the first floor, Maxwell Chamber. In Singapore, there is also a justice of peace. There is a concept where, you know, they actually facilitate the people. See, in a court, what happens, you know, I try to defeat him. because I wanted to prove my point, and lawyer has to prove his point, who is right. But arbitrator has to become a facilitator or a mediator, ideally, that what Chakradhar ji was telling. If a mediator comes and he will bring the party together, then it becomes a win-win situation for both of them. Otherwise, that hostility is continuing, which we don't want it. We wanted business to be continued. At one point of time, we also fight with our spouse, we also fight with our parents or with our children. It doesn't mean that we divorce with each other. It doesn't mean that we keep it in our mind. So in a business also, business has a lot of cultural things which is conflict which is happening between two partners. One is from Pawan and one is in India. So one has to mediate. Arbitrator has to do that role. And if India, having such a huge heritage, if they will be able to do it, then I think this is possible. But the first step we have to do it is to start considering from the mindset of GCs, and they have to start thinking that, you know, we have to see that, you know, I have to, he is my partner. I don't have to defend him. I wanted him to be back in my business again.
Intet plays a large role in terms of resolution. And if there are two fair parties, example could be Docomo versus Tata, then the question is to look at what needs to get done to get going in business. But if your intent is to only delay a claim from being successful or ensure that short-term ends for the business are meted, and you would like to just be a person who will be playing along with the members in the business who say that, no, no, for the time being, you get this stalled. If these are the thoughts which we would like to funnel as legal professionals, then I think we are also putting our own profession into doldrums. The fairness of intent to close, the fairness of looking at justice delivery, the fairness to walk along, to enter and find a solution, these ultimately determine how business will get the benefit of successful legal profession. And it is a role which we all need to play as both external counsel as well as in-house counsel. That's when I think we will evolve, our nation will evolve, and it will definitely become another Singapore in terms of people looking at you for business, for resolution.
Just to add, in a arbitration also provides for certain, you know, there are many kind of arbitration clauses like aap met aap. You start by an arbitration, in between you go for mediation. And if mediation is successful, then you come back to an arbitration and it becomes an award. And if mediation is failed, the arbitration will continue. So these kind of hybrid concepts are possible in an arbitration, but it is necessary that parties pre-decided before the dispute arrives. Because as I said, once a dispute arises, nobody will be willing to sit with the other party and decide on the issue. So if these kinds of clauses are also possible in an arbitration, and you can visualize it, a dispute, and how you want to solve it. So conciliation and mediation can also be incorporated in your arbitration clause. That once arbitration is initiated, you would parties make an endeavor to make go to mediation, and if it's successful, an award. If fails, then of course you have an arbitration already ongoing. So those hybrid concepts are also possible.
Even though Delhi High Court has a mediation cell, where whenever the matter is heard upon, the court, the judges persist that you go and mediation discuss together. The commercial dispute is there. Apart from that, if Arbitration Act 2015 is amended, there is a fast track procedure of 6 months also, where the arbitration can be taken care. So those things can be taken off as an in-house lawyer, as Mr. Everyone said, that we as a resolution partner, we need to work on those points. So we are the business lawyer basically, and business lawyer has to give a convincing figure to the business that this is the way out to work on, and this is the way out how we can resolve the issue. We are more of a resolution part. No business entity want to fight with other business entity. They always want to look into that, how we can come out of that.
We are completely out of time, so I'll take one question from the audience, if anybody is. Yeah.
Does the should choose an institutional arbitration or an ad hoc arbitration, relying on your experience and the best practices that have evolved? Is there any guidance in terms of any financial threshold, any particular type of industry, or any specific type of cases we should go to institutional arbitration rather than ad hoc arbitration?
In my opinion, institutional arbitration is the best, because They have rules. They have mechanism to check what is happening. They have a mechanism to supervise the whole process. Their fees schedule, their hearing schedule, everything is transparent. So you should always choose for an institutional arbitration, which will help you to cut down the cost as well as an efficiency in the whole flow of the arbitration.
In fact, the cost also, because cost is one of the big issues. In most of the institutional arbitration, the cost is fixed. Even the arbitrator's cost, the secretarial fees of the institute is fixed. So you know it upfront that this would be the cost for the arbitration. It is not that if the hearing is delayed for some reason or the arbitrator calls for more hearings, and you have to pay him per hearing. So I think institution arbitration is, of course, always better. It is structured. It is not at the whims of an arbitrator. And let's assume that we have had cases where arbitrators have resigned after hearing substantially a matter, probably a proceedings where he has heard the evidence or part heard the evidence or retired, and you have already paid him. So rather than the most of the institutes provide for such contingencies, they have a backup arbitrators who can take over from that position, and of course you're not put to an extra cost. So institutional arbitration, of course, is preferred over an ad hoc arbitration.
However, having said that, you know, there is a reason why in India, for some reason, the institutional arbitrations haven't done as much well as the ad hoc arbitrations. And that also is because of the freedom that you get in the ad hoc arbitration in terms of fixing your procedures, the way you want to conduct the arbitration. The kind of freedom that you get in an ad hoc arbitration, you do not necessarily get in the institutional arbitration. And therefore, it is not always that the cost is, you know, reasonable when you go into an institutional arbitration. While I'm myself a big propagator of institutional arbitrator, but it is also a matter of fact in terms of experience that we have seen, that there are ad hoc arbitrations who have been more successful is only because of the freedom that the parties have had in terms of deciding on how they want to go about it.
More than two decades ago, I have had the benefit of actually looking at Madhya Pradesh Bhopal having SOPA, Soya Oil Processors Association, and they used to have institutional arbitration, experts in the trade who look into issues of the traders, and they used to pass awards and issues get closed. And I have also had the other side experience in ITC's International Business Division, where GAFTA, FASFA, ASTA, American Spice Trader Association, and Grain and Feed Trader Association, and Feed and Oil Supply Seeds Association, all these have institutional arbitrations which were able to give clarity of thought in terms of what will be the proceeding, when does it happen, what are the rules applicable, who are the experts who are there, whom you can choose as arbitrators, what is their experience, what is their transparency level, everything is clearly known. I am also a votary of institutional arbitration, and in future, if something has to develop for India, similar to a Singapore jurisdiction, I think institutional arbitration is the way to go.
Thanks, everybody. A huge thanks to my panel. And it was a wonderful experience in a Friday evening to be with you. And obviously, all the batsmen have protected me from Michael Holding also, in that sense.
Thank you.
So thanks,
everyone. So thank you very much, Sunil. And with that, we come to an end of our, not only this session, but our today's program. But before we formally close our today's program, I'm going to request you, Sunil, to kindly present mementos to each one of our speakers, starting with Mr. Chakradhar. To Mr. KPS Kohli. To Mr. Pankaj Patel. To Mr. Sachin Kalra. To Ms. Shweta Bharti. And to Mr. S. Ravi Shankar. And I'm going to request Mr. Rajendra Mishra, Senior Vice President, General Counsel at the Indian Hotels Company, to kindly present a memento to Mr. Sameer Hussain on behalf of Flex Witness, and thank him. Well, thank you very much.